So you've heard about carpal tunnel syndrome, but how is it diagnosed exactly? That's done through what we call an EMG. That's a study with electrodes where they measure the time it takes for a nerve impulse to get to a certain point. And it's done in two different ways. And here to explain all you need to know about EMGs and doing an actual EMG on himself will be Dr. Norman Kahan.
We have our electrode, which I've set up here, is I've outlined the median nerve in blue or purple, and then red is the ulnar nerve. I'm not going to study the ulnar nerve today, but I'm going to tell you that when you do a nerve test, basically you're stimulating the nerve at a point 8 centimeters proximal to the reference. So this is going to be my reference or recording site, which I placed right over the abductor pollicis brevis muscle. And it's the terminal muscle on the median nerve. Now, if there's a compression here, it's going to take a little bit longer for the impulse to travel from this point to that reference. And that's how we simply diagnose carpal tunnel syndrome. If we want to compare this to the ulnar nerve, we would stimulate the nerve here, the ulnar nerve, and compare it the distance here and compare the two. So the median nerve innervates the thumb, the index, the long, and half of the ring finger. So when you have carpal tunnel, you might experience numbness or tingling or swelling or discomfort. Typically in the mornings, you'll shake your hand out and you'll notice it. Now, I personally have been experiencing some numbing and tingling in my hand. So I'm wondering, I might have carpal tunnel today, and that's something we're all gonna learn together. So I'm about to now demonstrate this. Here we go. I'm going to take my stimulating electrode and I'm going to add a little gel to improve the conductivity of the nerve so I don't have to stimulate my wrist excessively because it hurts a little bit. And I've set the parameters to study the median nerve. And this is my stimulation that I've increased the volume to about 52.4 milliamps, or the intensity. And I'm now going to find out if I have carpal tunnel syndrome or not. So here goes. I'm gonna simulate this and you're gonna feel a little twitch, and or I'm gonna feel the twitch and you're gonna see it. Woo, 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 that feels like a little twitch. It's not really terribly uncomfortable. Like on a scale of 0 to 10, somewhere about a 3 to a 6. And I now have an ability to test to see if I have carpal tunnel. So I'm gonna see how long it takes to get from here to that little spot. That spot is where the action potential reaches the muscle and you have an upward deflection. So I'm gonna see what my latency is. And it looks like it's 4.6 milliseconds. Now, that tells me that I have carpal tunnel syndrome. The word latency is the time from stimulation till the time it's received by the muscle. So that time course is the latency.
And if it's slow, it tells you that you've got carpal tunnel syndrome?
Yes. Now I have to do something. I have to make sure that the temperature in my hand is measured, because if my hand is cold, then the latency is going to be slow spuriously. So I'm going to check the temperature in my hand. I want it to be somewhere around 29 or 30 degrees.
That's cool. What is that instrument that you're holding?
This is a little temperature probe.
Wow.
And the temperature in my hand is 28.9 degrees centigrade. So that means that this test is pretty accurate. And it means that I have carpal tunnel syndrome. Now, I can also tell you that we have ways to determine if it's mild, moderate, or severe. And you might ask, why is that important? If it's mild, statistically speaking, you can get away with wearing a wrist splint or maybe an injection and modifying many of your activities. If it's moderate to severe, for instance, if these values would have been in the 5, 6, or 7 millisecond latency, then statistically speaking, I might need surgery down the line if the splints and the injections don't help. But I want the focus of today's visit to really be on nerve conduction studies. And what I've tried to show you is that I'm able to determine that I have carpal tunnel syndrome, mild, just by a simple stimulation of the nerve. And there are many different studies that have different measurements, but if you follow most of them, it's about an 8 centimeter distance from the stimulation point until the recording of the muscle. That's called the latency. And my latency today was 4.6. 4.3 or less would have been better. So I have some things to think about. Now I'm going to be wearing my wrist splint a little more often. And when I do anything that involves cold or vibration, I'll wear some warm gloves. I don't ride a motorcycle, so I don't need to worry about that, but I'm not too worried about it. I do have symptoms in the morning sometimes when I wake up, but I never have symptoms other times.
You talked about splints, but there are some cautions about splints. What should we know about the appropriate way to use a splint if you have carpal tunnel syndrome?
That's very good that you would ask that, because a lot of people wear their splints too much. So to keep it simple, you wear your splint at nighttime when you're unaware of things, when you're sleeping, for two reasons. When you have carpal tunnel, it's usually because there's a compression of the nerve right there. So if you sleep with your wrist bent, which we all do, then what happens is the compression becomes worse. So the wrists are designed to keep the wrists straight, and they don't have to be stiff. They can move about 5-10 degrees. So the wrist splints should feel loose, fitting, comfortable, so you can sleep, not really tight. You just want to minimize the movement of flexion extension or side bending to about 5 degrees either way. The second reason why you wear the splint at nighttime is because your blood pressure is lower. So the driving force of bringing oxygen from your heart to the nerve is lower. So by keeping the wrist straight, you get rid of the compression, and also you allow the flow of oxygen to be a little bit facilitated, because it's not just a preventive measure, it's the first line of treatment for carpal tunnel, is wearing a wrist splint at nighttime.
Yes, and the classic red flag of carpal tunnel syndrome is waking up at 4 a.m. in the morning with
right.
So right. If you have that happen, go see your doctor and get an EMG.
Or at least get a splint first.
Yes. Even though you're not going to do it today, could you talk a little bit about the needle EMG?
We have a little needle here, and it's called a monopolar needle, and it's very skinny, almost like an acupuncture pin. And what I'll do is I would take it out of its wrapper, and I would stick it right into the muscle. So go ahead and show where the muscle is. We call it the motor point of the muscle. And we place the needle inside, and when we ask the person to relax and then to contract, and we look and see the waveforms, the frequency of that particular impulse. And that can tell us a lot about whether the muscle is injured or not.
That's for the muscle more than the nerve.
It's for the muscle directly, but it helps you understand the nerve indirectly. So if there's a significant problem in the nerve, then the impulse will be read as abnormal in the muscle too, because it's a series connection, not parallel. So whatever pathology appears in the nerve can appear in the muscle too, and you can see findings. When it does become abnormal in the muscle, that's usually more severe, moderate to severe. So that would be definitely a reason to consider surgery if you have carpal tunnel syndrome, assuming you don't have other things that are also contributing to arm pain, such as a pinched nerve in the neck or a peripheral neuropathy or many other nerve type problems. So this nerve test helps you find out what you do have, but it's also very helpful in that it helps you differentiate this from other problems, which is really important to do before you ever consider surgery.
And when would a doctor prescribe this?
If a doctor or someone tells you you need an EMG, you expect to get both done at the same time. It's just that EMG is such a shorter word to say than electrodiagnostic medicine or nerve conduction studies. So when you're going to get this type of study, you're getting both for the most part.
And we really appreciate your showing us exactly what to expect. I think sure, that's Deborah, really helpful for people.
I appreciate your interest and thanks for helping all of us learn about carpal tunnel. In fact, because of you, I now know I have carpal tunnel. Thank you.
I don't know whether to say you're welcome or not, but
knowing is important.
Knowing is better than not knowing.
Maybe in another half a year, we can check and see if it got better or not. That's another valuable part of this test. You can see
it's
getting better or worse, especially during those times when you're not sure which way to go. Your doctor offers you surgery. You're not sure. Well, sometimes this can be the tiebreaker that tells you, hey, it's getting better. Maybe I'll wait a little longer, or it's worse or the same. And frankly, the same or worse to me is not good. You really want to get better.
I asked Dr. Kahan for some more advice about what kind of splints to buy. And he said that some of them fall apart and some of them aren't long enough to keep your wrist from bending. They can also take too much time to put on or off, and you might be doing that in the dark. I asked him which splint he likes, and you'll find the link to that in the details below. I hope you enjoyed this video, but there's a lot more that you can learn about repetitive strain injury. So be sure to watch the video that's coming up next.